ಎಷ್ಟು ಬೋರ್ಡ್
ಆಗಿರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ವಿಜಯ್ ಕುಮಾರ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ರೇವಾ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಸ್ಟಡೀಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್. ಹಿಯರ್ ಐ ಎಮ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಟಾಕ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಕಂಪ್ಯೂಟರ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸೇಷನ್ and one of the unit, that is fifth unit, on memory and its organization. So the main objective of today's discussion is to learn different components used to implement the memory, comparative study on memory, speed, cost and size, and also on study of cache memory, virtual memory concepts that increases the speed and size of the memory, and also some introduction about later on in the next session on secondary storage devices that provides larger storage capacity as a memory organization. As we know, so the memory is one of the vital part of the computer, so which will take a main role in execution of the program and also to store the data. And here the execution speed of programs highly dependent on the speed of memory access. So most of the computations which are going on in the computer are highly dependent on the memory access. So the time which the computer takes to execute the program, so therefore the speed of memory access is one of the key factor which we have to consider. And normally the maximum size of memory is determined by addressing scheme used by the computer. For example, computer that generate 16-bit address can address up to 2 to the power of 16 is equal to 64 kilo memory locations. So depending on the number of address bit, so the memory location size is defined. One more example, if there are 32 address lines, then we have 4 giga memory locations can be addressed. And also the memory is designed to store and retrieve data in word length of the computer. Normally the computers are having 4 bit word length, 8 bit word length or 16 bit word length. Accordingly the computer will access the data from the memory depending on the word length which is defined for that particular computer. Coming to the primary organization of the memory and its connection to the processor, so here it gives the simple connection strategy used, mechanism used for connecting memory to a processor. The processor has MAR, memory address register, which will hold the address of the memory to be the data to be accessed. And this, in this figure we have got k bit address lines and it is called bus. Memory address register will load the address and it will be given to the memory, and which will address the particular location of the memory. And here in this figure it is 2 to the power of k addressable memory, addressable locations are there in the memory because there is a k bit address. And MDR, memory data register, which will hold the data to be accessed or data to be stored in the memory, and the length of this number of bits, that word length of that computer depends on the MDR. This MDR size depends on the word length of that computer, which will either load the data onto the memory, or it may take the data from the memory, and MDR will be of length depending on the word length. In this case, it is n bit data, and it is connected through data bus. And also, to perform the action of read or write, so there are control lines which will control either it can read from the memory or we can write the data onto the memory using the control bit, either read or write bar. And also there is one more control line, memory function control complete. This memory function complete will say the access of the memory read when it starts, and after getting the data onto the data bus, that control signal will give the information that memory function is complete. And here is a simple explanation about the same. When we want to write some data onto the memory, and which is the write operation, and first the processor will load the address to memory address register and data onto memory data register, and control bit read write will go to 0, which will inform the memory that the data stored in MDR is to be loaded into the memory location addressed by MAR, which is the data stored in MAR. In that location the data will be loaded. Sometime we also have to access the set of data or a group of data from the memory, which can be accessed from the consecutive memory locations, and which involves either it can be read or write. We call such operation as block transfer. And normally this memory access and the control is either synchronized using a clock or a special signal. So, and most of the operations which are done in memory and its access, and getting either the program data, we have to have the some of the important parameter which are to be considered during the memory operations are memory access time. So here the time that elapses between the initiation of either read or write operation and the completion of that operation, that is called memory access time. So this is very important, because normally the total program execution time depends on, most of the time it is the access time which will give the program execution time, and therefore the one of the key parameter here is how much a memory will take to access the data and which will come and store in the MDR. And one more thing is how often we access the memory, and it is the memory cycle time. minimum time delay required between the initiation of two successive memory operations. Say for example, time between two successive read operations, or it can be two successive write operations, or it can be read once and write operation. How often? So it is memory cycle time. And in this there is one more, that is random access memory. When we are accessing the memory, can we able to access the memory content randomly, so that whichever the place, location the data is stored, we must be able to access it within the time that is required for the program to be executed. And in this case, we define the random access memory as a location of a memory unit that can be accessed for a read or write operation in a fixed amount of time, that is independent of the location's address. Either I can access the first location or 1000th location or 100th location, the time should be independent. So that is random access memory, we say. And in case of sequential memory access, suppose if you want to access the first location, it can be accessed as and when the read control signal is sent to the memory, it can be accessed. If you want to read the 100th location data, then we have to keep on accessing the next consecutive locations until 100th location memory location data is accessed. So that is a sequential access. And also, since the memory access is one of the key parameter which we have to consider here, to increase the speed of access, memory access, the other set of memory type of memories are defined, and they are designed, and they are called cache memory, and which are very small in size and they are fast, that is inserted between the slower main memory and the processor. Then also, this is very important, because nowadays you might have come across the cache memories which are very fast, and also they are little bit costlier, and which gives fast access to the memory and data can be accessed very fast. And in order to, because the program also requires huge amount of information to be stored, huge amount of access, that is program length is also more. In such cases, we have to go for one of the important concept, that is virtual memory, which will increases the apparent size of the physical memory. Here there is a separate memory control circuit that translates the address specified by the program into an address that can be used to access physical memory. Whenever the address is sent to the memory, it is the physical memory address. But normally the program addressing the particular location in the memory, that will be a virtual address or a logical address we call, and this has to be mapped onto the physical address, which it will access the particular location of the memory and access the data. So by this memory control, that is the virtual memory concept, it will also access the secondary memory, so wherein a proper mapping is required from the virtual address or the logical address specified by the program onto the physical address. And there is a separate special memory control unit is used for mapping virtual address space onto the physical memory address. And here the access could be a word or sometime it is a page. Page here is a group of words which will be accessed from the secondary memory, that is disk, and which needs proper mapping so that the physical memory can be accessed. And so far we have seen the simple activities which we perform in order to access the information, how many address lines and what are the different types of memory we come across normally, and also what are the key parameter which we look into the memory, look in the memory. Now let us look into how it is really organized, and that organization it's a simple organization is as shown here. In this we have address lines, there are four address lines and address decoder. This decoder will select any one of the word line, that is W0, W1 and W15. So decoder will select any one output line, that is word line we call here, and depending on the address given, if the address given is 0000, then the word line W0 will be selected, so that that select the complete row which is given here, that is B0, B1 up to B7. There are 8 bits, and here there are each row contain 8 bits, and such there are 16 rows, and each of this row contains 7 bits, and those 7 bits and each of them are called memory cell, which will hold the data to be stored either 0 or 1. Say for example, in a memory cell, if it is stored 1 in a B7, which is shown here, and then the B7 bar, it will store 0. And this information will be read by sensor and write circuit. This is a special circuit wherein we can either sense the information stored in a memory cell, or we can also write information into the particular memory cell. So here this sensor and write circuit, it's a bidirectional connection wherein we can either send the data into the memory cell, or we can read the information from the memory cell. The simple operation will be, I'll tell the simple operation of it. All the cells of a row connected to a common line, as I explained, called word line. You can make a note of this. Here, all cells of a row connected to a common line called word line, and cells of a column connected to a sense write circuit by 2 bit lines. As I said, it's a bit and its complement of it. And also there is one more control, that is chip select. Which selects a given chip in a multi-chip memory system, because it is not only this memory which we are connecting to the processor, there may be multiple memory, such kind of memory chips which we connect. Therefore, in order to select the particular chip, we have to use this chip select, which will select the particular memory unit. So in this case, there are 128 bits stored in the previous figure which I shown, 128 bits, and each bit, if you give address on the address lines 0001, then the word line W1 will be selected and it will enable all the memory cell on this particular row. And at that time when we are send the control signal here, read in this point, the read signal. So then if the bit is 1, that means we are doing read operation from the particular row W1, the memory cell content will be sensed by the sensor circuit and it will be put on to the bit line B0 to B7. And this is the data we read from the, that is the content which is stored in the row 1, that is W1, and it will be read on into the, it will be taken from the bits B0 to B7 and it will be directly sent to the memory data register which I have shown earlier, and it will be stored into the computer. So this is how the simple organization of bit cells in a memory chip. In this case, how many external connections normally required for this particular memory chip? There are 14 external connections, that is there are 4 address lines and 8 data lines, and there are 8 plus 4 12 and 3 control, 2 control lines for power and ground. So in total 14 external connections are present in the particular memory chip. Similarly, the another organization of the memory, it is shown here, memory chip, that is 1K into 1. 1K means 1 kilo of memory with 1 bit. So this is 1024 cells are present in this. So there are 32 into 32 cell array. And how is the organization here? How will we access 1 bit from out of 1024 cells? Here, since it is 1024 locations we have to address, we need 10 bit address lines. So there are 10 bit address lines, and in this organization what is done is there is a 5 bit decoder which will access any one of the output depending on the address that is given over the row address, that is 5 bit, and it will enable one of the output of the 5 bit decoder and it will access the particular row on the 32 cross 32 memory cell array. As I shown previous figure, the cell array there it was 15 cross 8 cell array. So here it is 16 cross 8, sorry. So there are 32 cross 32 memory cell, and in this case if you enable the first row, that is by giving address 0000, W0 will be addressed, the particular row will enable that particular memory cell array. And if you are reading, if you are doing the read operation, then the control signal that is sent from the processor is R, that is read, and bit is 1, and that will enable the sense circuit to read all the 32 bit information onto this multiplexer. So output multiplexer and input is demultiplexer. So multiplexer means out of 32 data which has been read from the sense circuit when you are doing read operation, and this multiplexer will give, select any one of the data depending on the remaining 5 address lines here. The 10 bit address which are used for 5 bit for row address, and here 5 bit is used for column address, which will specify which bit out of 32 are to be output from the memory. And similarly if you want to write some information, the address, 10-bit address, is given, and it will decode it, and particular row will be enabled, and the data to be sent on will be sent on the data input, and it will demultiplex, and we are doing write operation. Therefore, this particular bit goes 0. Anyhow, the chip select is enabled because we have selected this particular memory chip, and it will write onto the particular cell in the memory depending on what address we send on the 5-bit column address. So this is the simple memory organization. And let us come to the different types of memories. So memories capable of retaining their state, that is retaining the state as long as power is applied, are known as static memories. Static memories normally have two inverters cross connected to form a latch. See here in the figure, we see there are two latch which will be connected back to back, and there are bit lines as we show in the first figure, the simple organization. In that we have seen the memory cell, this is one of that, and in this we have got two transistors T1 and T2, and whenever we send, this is word line, this is word line, and this, when we enable this word line by using proper decoder decoding the address, and this is enabled, and it will switch on T1 and T2. And suppose if you want to read the content of this latch which is connected, and the data will be read onto the bit, if the data stored is 1, the 1 will be stored x is equal to 1 and y will be 0. You can see this logic here, and we can read on the bit line the content of the particular static memory. And in this case we can look at the read operation. Word line is activated to close, that is T1 and T2 will be on. If the cell is in the state 1, the signal on bit lines B is high and B bar is low, and vice versa for state 0. So for state 0, if it stores, and B will be 0 and B bar will be 1. Sense circuit monitor B and B bar and output to the data line. Similarly, write operation. The state of the cell is set by placing the appropriate value on bit line B and B bar, its complement on B bar, and then activating the word line. So it will store the particular information onto that particular memory cell. And required signals are generated by sense write circuit here. And this is one of the example which uses CMOS memory cell, because nowadays CMOS memories are low power devices which we can use CMOS which will consume less power. And in this simple circuit you can see the same, that is inverting latch which I have shown in the previous circuit, it is connected by 4 transistors, and these T1 and T2 are the normal connecting transistors which will connect the bit line to the latch. And in this figure we can say whenever we want to store information 1, and this will enable the transistor T3 and T6. T3 and T6 will be on, and T4 and T5 will be off. And the voltage we supply is 5 volts or 3.3 volts. And this is CMOS, normally voltage is 5 volts or 3.3 volts, and which is a low power consumption device. And this will make the information stored in this T3 T3 and T6 which will hold that data and when they are on, and T4 and T5 are off, therefore it will hold data at this point 0 and particular bit B bar is 0, and similarly vice versa. If you want to store 0 and bit T6 are off, and T4 and T5 will be on. So accordingly the circuit works as a latch, and T1 and T2 and one transistor in each inverter is turned off, ensuring no active path between voltage supply and ground. So accessed very quickly, that is in terms of nanoseconds, we can access this kind of the information from this kind of circuit very quickly, and it is in terms of nanoseconds. And these CMOS memory cells are normally used in applications where speed is of critical concern. Let us coming to the next type of memories, that is less expensive random access memories, and store information in the cell. And in this case, dynamic RAM, we store the information in the form of charge on a capacitor for a short time. And in this case, the cells do not retain their state indefinitely. That is one more important thing which we have to remember here, because the charge on a capacitor may discharge through its resistance which is present in the transistor, and slowly it may get discharged. The content that is stored in the capacitor, it may get lost. Therefore, we need periodic refreshing of charge, that is restoring capacitor charge to full value, so that it will retain the information that is stored in the capacitor. This is the simple circuit which shows the same first circuit which I have shown. There is a word line and a bit line, and this word line will switch on the transistor, and it will make the capacitor to give its charged voltage on the bit line. So this will make us to read the content of the capacitor. If it is charged, we take that as it is bit 1, and if it is there is no charge, we call this is the bit 0 is stored. Similarly, if you want to store the information into this kind of dynamic RAMs, we use the transistor T which is turned on and appropriate voltage applied to the bit line in order to make the capacitor to charge, so that it will hold the information and causes a known amount of charge to be stored in the capacitor. It will store that information. To maintain the information, discharge of capacitor caused by capacitor own leakage resistance. Sorry, it was a leakage resistance which will make the capacitor to discharge. So, and therefore, we have to maintain that charge, and we have to do refreshing of the capacitor. And here, transistor conducts a tiny amount of current which is measured in picoamperes, and information is retrieved is correct from this only if it is read before the charge drops down below the threshold value. If it is below the threshold value, we are not able to identify what is the content of the memory cell, that is charge in the capacitor. Therefore, we have to refresh every time. That is This is one more operation which we perform, that is the read operation. Transistor in a selected cell is turned on and sense amplifier detects the charge for threshold value. If charge on C, that is capacitor, is above the threshold value, greater than threshold value, sense amplifier drives the bit line to high voltage and stores 1. And if charge on C is less than threshold value, makes bit line to ground value, storing logic 0 and no charge. Cells selected in a row and refreshes the entire row. So, and also similarly, the read operation, we are going to read the content of the charge. If it is stored, it will be 1. Charge is stored, and if the charge is not stored, it will be taken as logic 0. Similarly, as we studied the previously, that is a basic organization of the memory, and here it is another using dynamic memory structure, the internal organization 2 MB into 8, so which is having a row, there are address lines which are multiplexed here. So we are going to send the address on the same lines. So there are address lines 0 to 8 and 9 to 20, and these are row address latch which will hold the address of the row and row decoder, and correspondingly it will select any one of these word. And this is the cell array which has got 4096 into 512 into 8 cell array, and similar to the selection of the word, and it will select any one of that row, and the sense circuit will sense that 8 bits, and those 8 bits, the column address latch will give how to access out of these 512 the 8 bits output. So the column address latch, which will hold the address that is lower part of the address, that is 0 to 8, that is 9 bits, and remaining 12 bits to access any one of the row, that is 4096, and remaining address lines are used to access. So 9 address lines are used to access the column. Out of 512, 8 bit are to be selected. So this column address latch hold the information of the address and which column the data has to be read, that is 8 bit. And one more thing here in the organization, we have got RAS and CAS, that is row access strobe and column access strobe. So this strobe signal will tell so the simple organization, I will repeat it. There are 4096 cells in each row, are divided into 512 groups of 8, and each row 512 bytes of data, and 12 address bits are needed to select a row, and 9 bits are needed to specify a group of 8 bits in the selected column, and 21 bit address is needed to access a byte in this memory. High order bits are 12 bits, which is used for row, and low order is 9 bits, and that is column. And during read operation, row address is applied first. It is loaded into row address latch in response to a signal pulse on RAS, that is row address strobe input of the chip. Read operation is initiated. Control address is applied to the address pins and loaded into the column address latch under the control of CAS, column address strobe. Information on this is decoded and appropriate group of 8 sense write circuits are selected. If it is a read operation, data are transferred on D0 to D7. If write operation, information is transferred to the selected circuit. Applying row address, we can refresh all cells and during the read and write operation, because dynamic RAM required refreshing, as I explained earlier. To retain the content of each row of cells, most be accessed period cells must be, it is must, it is not most, it is must. Each row of cells must be accessed periodically, and refresh circuit is used to perform refresh automatically. Timing is controlled asynchronously. Therefore, these are all asynchronous dynamic RAMs we call. Because of high density and low cost, DRAMs are used in computers and to read data in parallel. And to have flexibility, and different organization of this same cell, the array structure, some of them is 16 megabit, it can be 64 megabit locations of the memory, can be 16 mega cross 4 or 8 mega into 8, 4 mega into 16. So depending on the word length, we can organize the memory structure, and depending on that we can choose the particular memory chip. Sometime we want to access the information in a fast, when the program needs the data to be accessed consecutively and data are stored in the memory consecutive locations, and in during that time we can just give to access the other bytes in the same row without having to reselect the row. That means to say, the particular row, as I said in the previous circuit, the particular row, if you want to select any one of the row which we selected, there are 512 different, and if you want to consecutive memory location the data is stored, then immediately we can change only the column address. Row address remains same and column address are different. Column addresses will replace different bytes on the data line so that we can read consecutively. The transfer of bytes in sequential order is achieved by applying a consecutive sequence of column addresses under the control of successive CAS, that is column address strobe signals. Consecutively we can access. So this will perform block transfer. Transferring a block takes place faster, and this block transfer capability, this block transfer capability is fast page mode, we say. In asynchronous dynamic RAMs, we can also access the information fast, as I said earlier. Now coming to the synchronous dynamic RAMs. Here the synchronous, here the dynamic RAMs are with a direct synchronization with a clock signals are called SDRAMs. But each cell array is same as in previous asynchronous DRAMs, but address and data lines buffered by means of registers. In this case it is buffered, and built-in refresh circuitry is provided and provides the address of the rows selected for refreshing at least every 64 milliseconds, because we have to recharge the capacitor to hold the data which has been stored in the memory. Read operation causes the content of all cells in the selected row to be loaded into the latches. So And the figure, which the simple synchronous DRAMs I could show here, the row and column address as usual, which is multiplexed, and row address latch, column address counter, and it will latch the refresh counter, which will refresh, it is used for refreshing the cell. And this is row decoder, which will decode one of the word line, which I shown in the earlier figure, and also column address counter, which will decode the column decoder, and read and write circuit latches this data, in that either we may read the content of the cell, whichever the row is selected, and depending on the column, depending on the word length of that particular processor. So the same type of DRAMs are used, where the word length here we can access the data through we can access the data from the memory, or else we can also store the information into the memory as it was explained earlier. And also here we have got the mode of operation. That is, SDRAM operate in several modes of operation, which can be selected by writing control information into a mode register. That is, this is the mode register which we can store. Burst operation for block transfer with fast page mode, which I explained earlier, the fast page mode, which will access the consecutive memory location by sending only the column address continuously one after the other. Successive columns are generated by necessary control signals provided internally using a column counter and clock signals. All actions in this DRAMs are triggered by the rising edge of the clock. So the rising edge of the clock will be the actions will be triggered, that is read operation, write operations, and loading the particular word. Here you can see the clock. Here we want to do the read operation, read of length 4 on SDRAM. That means we are reading the length 4, that is 4 data from the memory. That is, read bit is high here, that is high. And RAS row register, first we give this row address which has gone low, that is 0. RAS bar complement means it is active low, and it will send that row address. And after 3 clock cycle, it will vary, 2 to 3 clock cycle, it will take latch that information, and then we are going to send the column address. And after column address is given, the data will be taken in the next D0, D1 and D2 and D3 are taken by every clock signal. As I said, the rising edge of the clock, which it will get the data onto the data line, and since it is a read operation, we will get the data on the data output register, which output that data from the memory, and it will go to the processor, that is memory data register. So this is a synchronous DRAM and its operations. DRAMs whose operation is synchronized directly with the clock signal are, why we call this is a synchronous, because operations are synchronized with the clock signal, therefore it is synchronous DRAMs. Address and data are buffered by registers, and address, row address is latched under control of RAS 2 clock cycle, CAS 2 clock cycle, and data placed on data line. delay of one clock cycle, and SDRAM automatically increments the column address to access the next three sets of bits in the selected row and are placed on the data lines in the next three clock cycle, as it was shown in the previous figure. So here in this case, so this is the operation and the organization of a synchronous dynamic RAMs. And here we define some of the parameters which are really required as far as the time, that is the speed of the memory access, is concerned, that is latency and bandwidth. We define memory latency is the amount of time it takes to transfer a word of data to or from the memory, that is memory latency. Burst operation latency is the time it takes to transfer the first word of data, and this time is substantially longer than the time needed to transfer subsequent word of a block, because the first time when we access, it will take the time, substantial longer time, and later on it will be one after the other column address can be given, and subsequent transfer will be fast. Therefore we define burst operation latency is the time it takes to transfer the first word of data, and this time is substantially longer. And another one is, which we measure, is bandwidth. Bandwidth is the number of bits or bytes that can be transferred in 1 second. So in 1 second, how many number of bits or bytes, it depends on the word length. The bandwidth of memory unit depends on the speed of access to the stored data and the number of bits that can be accessed in parallel. Therefore we define bandwidth is the product of the rate at which data are transferred and accessed, which data transferred and accessed, and the width of the data bus. And with this we also have memory device that accesses cell array as in SDRAM, but transfers data both edges of the clock, and which we can speed up. Their bandwidth is doubled for long burst transfer and is known as double data rate SDRAM. To make it possible, the cell array is organized in two banks, that is two sets of memory locations. Each bank can be accessed separately. Consecutive word stored in different banks and interleaving of words allow simultaneous access to two words that are transferred on successive edges of the clock, so that we can increase the speed, the data rate can be increased by using bank, two different banks, and each are accessed. Interleaving of words allow simultaneous access to two words which are transferred on successive edge of the clock. And normally these synchronous DRAMs are used in general purpose computer, in which main memory transfers are primarily to and from the processor caches, and also used in block transfer such as high quality video displays. And today we have studied about the basic organization, the basic components which are used in the simple memory construction, and about asynchronous and dynamic RAMs, and also about synchronous dynamic RAMs and their organization, and how the time, that speed of access of the information is important in the access of the memory content. Thank you. Yeah? And if you have any questions in this, you can ask me. And also I will come back in the next session about how we can consider the virtual memory and other memory organizations. Thank you very much. Can I go back? If you have any questions from Lakshmeshwar, can you please ask me any questions you have? Any students? Because it is a preliminary part of memory and its organization. Not careful. No. Not asking. Thank you very much. And thank you. I will come back next week. Thank you very much.